Welcome to Let's Talk with Sarah. I have someone here with me who is quite the expert on the issue, considering he is now the special envoy for the Norwegian Ministry of Climate and Environment. Did I get that right? I did get that right, yes. Mr. Stig Travik, and you are specifically covering the Norway's International Climate and Forest Initiative. We are happy to see you here again with us. Well, first of all, we hear a lot about climate change now. We hear a lot about climate initiatives, about the environment, sustainability. Those are key words that are hot issues nowadays. But frustratingly, there are still quite a lot of people who seem to either remain ignorant or are unaware of it, or they choose to deny it. I want us to maybe give a little bit of perspective, you know, our perspective on this issue.
Well, first of all, Sarah, thank you so much for inviting me. I'm so happy to be able to catch up with you.
Thank you.
And I think you're posing the question right. Yeah, there's a lot of talk but little action. Mm-hmm. And I think part of the problem, the way we approach it, is that nature is at the core. We have to be at peace with nature. We have to be allied with nature.
I like that word, allied.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that is the problem, that for a long time we have been at war with nature. We've been cutting down forests.
We're just taking.
We're taking. We're more and more people. And we think that there's an endless limit to what you can take. No,
right.
In our private lives, there is not an endless limit to what you can take.
Right.
So now it's time to start giving back, to give nature more space.
I was going to ask, well, what do you think about the fires that happened here in Indonesia, that people are saying it was caused on purpose by certain companies?
What I can say is that Indonesia is among the countries that have had a lot of progress. So if you look historically, Indonesia was in a very problematic place, losing a lot of forest every year. Since the last 10-12 years, Indonesia has done better year by year. So, of course, it takes time to bring things under control. But I would really compliment the Indonesian government, and I think now internationally also, Indonesia is recognized as a country where things are going in the right direction.
In the right direction.
I think there's a recognition.
Well, that's good to know. Phew!
But I think there's a recognition, and I think in Indonesia people have understood one very important thing, is to manage water is an important part of this. Because part of the problem with fires was about draining peatlands, and then once it starts burning, it doesn't stop. Yeah?
No.
Once you have dry peat,
that's it.
It's a big bonfire.
Yeah.
Well, now I'm curious. What would be your personal perspective, perhaps, on some leaders in the world who, maybe not denying, but they refuse to do anything about climate change?
No, as you, I get frustrated. I mean, to see what happened in Madrid last time, I think we failed. One thing is the climate deniers. I think somehow it's becoming more and more marginal. There are fewer and fewer countries.
Hopefully.
where that is the main problem. But the other thing you pointed to is those who accept that there's a problem, but saying that, oh, but it's too expensive to do anything about it,
or
it's not our responsibility, somebody else needs to move first. I think we all need to move.
We all need
to
move together. Yeah.
And I think also there's the first thing we can do is to take responsibility for our own nature and sort of agree that we need more nature, not less. That's sort of step number one.
Yes.
And I think, as you said, we cannot expect people to change their diets overnight, but I think we can all think, okay, we can reduce a little bit our meat consumption. We can consume healthier stuff.
Yes.
We can think about when we're traveling somewhere, is it possible to go by train?
Right. I think it's frustrating when people see and they say, well, it's cheaper to get the cars that run by fuel instead of the hybrids by now we should have completely electrical cars. We do have the technology.
Yeah.
But in a way, it's not fully supported by the climate of, I'm talking climate in this case, it's the business and governments to ensure that there are charging stations, there are et cetera.
Yeah. I think that will probably be one of the big sort of political debates also is how do we do this transition? How do we make the transition fair so that it's cheaper and easier to do the right thing and more expensive and cumbersome to do the wrong thing?
It's all about
thing.
Political will at the end of the day, in a way. Right?
Political will and also, you know, finding a right way of doing it. Because I think the transition will be painful. And then comes the
as any change.
Yeah.
It's like growing pains, right? Yeah. For us to be more mature, it takes going through some difficult things in our lives.
So we need to find ways of doing it that people perceive as fair as well.
Right.
But that being said, you know, I think there's also a generational thing here.
Yeah.
Young people are
more and more.
They're pushing us, and I think it's an interesting situation in a way, because if you look at our situation with our parents' generation, we might have thought when we were young that they were conservative, they were slow, that they were, you know, that they were not taking opportunities that they didn't understand.
Right.
But we didn't see them as irresponsible.
No.
I think it's a very interesting situation where the young people look at all the people and say, you're irresponsible.
it's about perspective too, right? Because I think in those days, I mean, for example, the part of the reason why I think now more and more people are aware of it is because of social media as well and the technology of communication. I don't agree that, you know, that the generations before are irresponsible, but it would be irresponsible now if you already know the facts and you have the data and you still don't do anything about it. And what I mean by you is, you know, all you leaders. Now, so we were talking about leaders, but I wonder, what do you say to those who say, well, I don't live in a coastal city, it doesn't affect me. What should I say to them?
Yeah. I think there are a few things that people, wherever they live in the world, need to be aware of. Yeah, one is food security.
I mean,
once rain patterns start changing, the food security where you live is going to go down. You're going to see failed harvests. Then I think also about stability. I mean, yes, your country might not be directly affected, but if your neighbor's house is on fire, it affects you. And I think this is also something that we've been seeing, that in regions that become too dry, you can get migration, you can get all kinds of instability that we don't have the tools to handle, or Australia,
where we might have massive migration because of this. You're right.
I think also people can relate to seeing nature, seeing that animals lose their habitat. I mean, one thing is in the past where we had problems with big animals going extinct.
Yes.
People woke up to that.
Yes.
But then we're losing species at an alarming rate. And we're losing species that we really do need. I mean, bees.
And I think studies were done that, you know, if we lose the bees...
Yeah, we're done.
We're done.
No more agriculture. So we need to, you know, support the small farmers who are in connected to nature. Use less pesticides. Eat what is available locally as much as...
The farm-to-table philosophy again.
I think you talked about technology earlier. Yeah, I think you pointed out the importance of that, and I completely agree with you that, you know, we need to invest more in technology
that are sustainable.
Yeah, and that promotes sort of how can we aggregate the production of small farmers, get it to the table faster with less loss. I think this is where technology can be useful,
absolutely,
and where young people might want to invest, and we need to direct capital to that. And we need to, you know, make it clear to the big banks that, no, you don't loan money to terrorists, you don't loan money to people who have child labor, and no, you don't loan money to people who destroy nature.
Come on.
I mean, it's 2020,
it makes sense, logical sense, come on, absolutely. Okay,
what you said, how... even though it's just one country, quote unquote, just one country, but the effects of that one country to all its neighbors and the region.
Yeah.
And it's the same as, you know, whether it's Indonesia, Brazil, what, you know, termed as the lumps of the world, but whatever happens here does affect the rest of the region and the rest of the world in that sense. So I think that's a fantastic way to end this. I think that that's a message that we need to send out. And for all of you who are naysayers and deniers, go look it up, okay? You don't have to take our words for it, but at least do some research, find out, and see for yourself, really. And we'll end it there. Thanks so much. Tune in next time.